ROCKJUMPERS, Episode 1. In the year 3300, humanity's relentless pursuit of the galaxy's rarest resources propels it into the furthest reaches of space under the banner of the mega-mining corporation ROCKJUMPERS. This era of exploration and exploitation is on a scale never before imagined, with ROCKJUMPERS leading the charge with its fleet of advanced mining ships, each a beacon of human ingenuity and ambition. Their latest venture targets a remote planet, a mysterious orb from which all probes sent have mysteriously ceased transmission, sparking intrigue and a hunger for discovery among the corporation's ranks. The RJS Endeavor, a ship with a reputation as solid as the corporation it serves, approaches this enigmatic world. Its crew, a collection of ROCKJUMPERS' finest, awakens from the depths of cryo-sleep, a process that halts the march of time for those who dare to traverse the vast distances between stars. Captain Bick Rocker, a name synonymous with the bold spirit of ROCKJUMPERS, gathers his crew for a briefing that sets the tone for their daunting mission. "We stand at the edge of the unknown," Captain Rocker begins, his voice cutting through the anticipation. "The probes have gone silent, but we will not." Captain Rocker declares, "We are ROCKJUMPERS. We leap where others fear to tread. Prepare for descent." As the dropship leaves the RJS Endeavor and breaches the planet's atmosphere, a violent storm of cosmic dust and electromagnetic turbulence engulfs the ship. The outer hull screeches in protest, the heat shields flirt with failure, and the thrusters, those mighty engines of descent, sputter and gasp, fighting against the planet's unwelcoming gravitational embrace. Alarms blare as the crew braces for what may come, each member's face displaying a blend of determination and fear. Alarms scream, a cacophony of warnings blare as the hull glows red with heat, pushing the limits of the ship's engineering. "Thruster 2 is out," cries the pilot as he maneuvers the ship through the tempest, compensating with auxiliary systems. "Brace for impact." The ship, a metal phoenix, wrestles with the atmosphere's fiery grip. It is a dance with death, with ingenuity born of necessity and a touch of luck. The pilot maneuvers the dropship. It emerges from the fog. The crew exhales in unison, a momentary relief as they see the shadows of the planet's surface appear below. They have survived the descent, but the true test lies ahead. "Damage report," Captain Rocker commands, his gaze fixed on the swirling mists of the planet below, a challenge laid bare. "We've made it this far, crew. Remember, we are ROCKJUMPERS. Adversity is but a stepping stone to greatness." After ensuring the ship was securely positioned in a relatively clear area, dense with the towering alien flora, seemingly safe from immediate threats, the crew initiated the core drilling mission. Captain Bick Rocker, with his characteristic blend of caution and resolve, supervised the deployment of the drilling equipment, a high-tech assemblage of sensors, drills, and collection canisters designed for the precise task of extracting planetary samples. The scientists aboard, experts in geology and xenomineralogy, eagerly took the lead, their eyes alight with the prospect of uncovering resources or elements unknown to humanity. The operation commenced with the smooth precision of a well-rehearsed procedure. The drill bit, made of a diamond-titanium composite, spun to life, burrowing into the alien soil with a hum that resonated through the dense jungle air. Meanwhile, the space marshals who had hitchhiked with the Endeavor on behalf of ROCKJUMPERS Corporation began their own investigation, tasked with probing the mysteries surrounding the lost probes, whether incidents of sabotage by rival corporations or interference by unknown entities. They moved quietly, blending with the shadows of the towering vegetation in search for the missing probe's location. However, their mission of exploration was soon interrupted by the unexpected emergence of the planet's native fauna. From the verdant underbrush, creatures with gleaming exoskeletons, reminiscent of Earth's ancient raptors but with a terrifying alien twist, launched an assault on the crew. These beings, fierce and seemingly intelligent, displayed an aggressive territoriality and a coordination in their attacks that suggested a complex social structure. A fierce skirmish unfolded between the space marshals and the exoskeletal creatures. The marshals, seasoned in the art of combat across the stars, quickly formed a defensive perimeter, their advanced weaponry at the ready. As the creatures surged forward with startling speed, their exoskeletons glinting under their spotlights, the air was filled with the crackle and hum of energy weapons clashing against their natural armor. The marshals worked in seamless unity, their movements precise. Each blast from their rifles was calculated, aiming to slow the tide of ferocious beings that seemed almost impervious to harm. Despite their tactical superiority and combat prowess, the marshals found themselves pressed from all sides, the creatures' numbers overwhelming, their attacks coordinated with an unsettling intelligence. It was in this moment of intense conflict, amidst the chaos of energy fire and the raw fury of the creatures, that the decision was made to fall back to the drill site, a decision born of necessity and the stark realization that this battle could not be won by firepower alone. The marshals' disciplined retreat, covering each other's movements with controlled volleys of fire, was a testament to their training and resolve, but also an acknowledgement of the formidable and unexpected challenge posed by this alien world's guardians. The attackers, however, were undeterred. Their exoskeletons provided formidable protection against the space marshals' weaponry, turning the retreat into a desperate battle for survival. The realization that these creatures were drawn to the drilling operation, perhaps by the vibrations or the unearthed materials, added a horrifying new layer to the encounter. It suggested not only a natural predation, but a deeper, possibly sentient connection. The battle against the relentless horde of exoskeletal raptors was rapidly turning dire, with the space between the beleaguered defenders and the surging predators diminishing with every passing moment. The energy weapons of the space marshals, though fierce and bright, were not enough to stem the tide of the advancing beasts. Their roars tore through the air, a symphony of primal aggression, as their claws found the ship's metal hull and their eyes burned with a hunger for the fray. Amidst the chaos, Captain Bickrocker recognized the grim turn of events. The marshals and the crew, with their backs against the dropship, faced an onslaught that threatened to overwhelm them. In a moment of tactical desperation, Rocker's voice cut through the din, commanding and clear. "Grenades!" he shouted, his order slicing through the despair. "Everyone, on three. One, two, three. Now!" The synchronized release of thermal grenades was a last defiant stand against the encroaching darkness. As the crew hurled their grenades into the maw of the oncoming horde, time seemed to slow. The small cylindrical devices arcing gracefully through the air before finding their mark amidst the raptors. The detonations that followed were cataclysmic. Fire and force erupted in a series of blinding flashes, the concussive waves rolling outwards, tearing through the ranks of the raptors with merciless efficiency. The carnage was immediate and devastating. Raptors caught in the blast radius were instantly incinerated, their exoskeletons offering no protection against the intense heat and shockwave. The explosions tore through flesh and bone, sending charred remnants scattering like leaves in a storm. The air filled with the acrid scent of burned flesh and the eerie glow of embers floating back to the ground, painting a hellish tableau of destruction. As one of the space marshals shouts out, "Welcome to the barbecue, baby." In the immediate aftermath, the jungle was silent, save for the crackling of fires and the distant pained cries of the surviving raptors. The ground around the dropship was a charred wasteland, the vegetation scorched, the earth blackened. The creature's advance had been halted, if only momentarily, by the devastating efficiency of human technology. In the heated aftermath of their narrow escape, as the crew hurried to prepare the dropship for an immediate departure from the perilous planet, Captain Bickrocker's command was clear and unequivocal: leave everything behind and evacuate. It was a directive born of necessity, prioritizing the safety of his crew over the mission's material gains. However, this order was met with stark opposition by the lead scientist, who, in a moment fueled by both desperation and discovery, vehemently objected. "Wait!" he protested, rising to challenge the captain's decision with a fervor that commanded attention. "We've unearthed a resource here that defies all our expectations, something so valuable it's beyond calculation. We're sitting on a treasure trove. His argument was compelling, underscored by the tangible evidence of a small sample already secured on the ship, a sample that hinted at fortunes beyond any of their imaginations. With animated gestures and a voice laced with the excitement of potential wealth, the lead scientist made his case. This isn't just about scientific discovery, it's about the chance to redefine our futures. With the amount of the resource we've detected, we could all be at the helm of our own enterprises, masters of wealth and power beyond our wildest dreams. As the dropship's engines roared to life, a defiant rumble against the backdrop of an alien world that had almost claimed them, Captain Bick Rocker, with a steely resolve in his eyes, made one final, decisive move before the ship tore itself away from the planet's gravitational embrace. He shoved a pulse rifle into the lead scientist's hands, pressing him against the wall with a gravity that matched their situation. You want those core samples? Assemble volunteers and get them, but this ship lifts off in 10 minutes, with or without you. His voice, hard and unyielding, left no room for argument. We've paid in blood. Too many have fallen. It's time to go. Driven by a blend of determination and the magnetic pull of wealth, the scientist, accompanied by a dozen brave souls, ventured out from the relative safety of the dropship towards the drill site, a mere 30 yards away, but worlds apart in terms of danger. Their mission was clear: retrieve the core samples that promised untold riches and a discovery for the ages. As the group made their way back to the ship, laden with the precious samples, the creatures, masters of stealth, had set a trap. Their understanding of the terrain and its tactical advantages honed through eons of evolution. The ambush was sprung with ferocious precision. From the underbrush, the raptors surged, their exoskeletal forms a blur of motion, overwhelming the party with a speed and ferocity that left no room for defense or escape. The air was torn with the cries of the ambushed crew, their pleas for help a desperate refrain against the backdrop of the jungle's indifferent chorus. Captain Bick Rocker, witnessing the unfolding tragedy from the ship's hatch, faced an agonizing decision. The screams of his crewmates and friends, echoing the primal fear of prey ensnared, clawed at his resolve. Yet, the captain's duty, the heavy burden of command, left him with no choice but to secure the safety of the remaining crew and the mission's broader objectives. With a heart heavy with sorrow and eyes blurred with a tumult of emotion, he gave the order to close the hatch, sealing the fate of those outside. The ship's engines ignited, propelling the dropship skyward, leaving behind the planet and its lethal inhabitants, along with the men who had dared to dream of wealth beyond measure, but found instead the ultimate price of their ambition. As the ship broke atmosphere, the silence that settled over the crew was not just the void of space enveloping them, but the weight of loss and the stark reminder of their vulnerability in the vast, uncaring expanse of the universe. The liftoff marked not just a physical departure from the planet, but a somber reflection on the cost of human greed, the limits of ambition, and the unfathomable complexities of life that thrived in the shadows of the stars. Rockjumpers, Episode 2. The atmosphere aboard the RJS Endeavor was a maelstrom of contrasting emotions as the ship orbited the enigmatic planet below. The crew, weary and diminished from their harrowing encounter with the planet's fearsome inhabitants, bore the weight of loss and exhaustion. Yet, against this somber mood was a current of electric excitement that crackled through the communication channels from Rockjumpers Corporation. The discovery of an unknown, incredibly valuable resource on the planet had ignited a fervor among the corporate ranks, a fervor for wealth and prestige that seemed to overshadow the very real dangers the crew had just faced. Captain Bick Rocker, his features etched with fatigue and the residue of battle, received the corporation's directive with a heavy heart. Despite their losses, despite the plea for return, the order was unequivocal: remain in orbit. The corporation's ambition stretched far beyond the immediate safety of the crew, aiming to secure the mining rights to the planet by establishing a permanent base. Such a foothold was not just a claim to the riches beneath the surface, it was a beacon of ownership, a flag planted in alien soil that declared the world and its treasures the property of the Rockjumpers Corporation. Reluctantly, Captain Rocker convened his crew, conveying the orders with a voice that carried both his reluctance and the resolve to see through his duties. "We're not heading home. Not yet," he announced, his gaze sweeping across the faces of his crew, each shadowed by the recent ordeal. "Rockjumpers wants a base on the surface, a claim to this place. It's on us to make that happen." The tension in the room was palpable, a mix of disbelief, anger, and a hardened determination to endure what was to come. The next phase of their mission centered on the deployment of a prefabricated base, a marvel of engineering designed to withstand the harshest alien environments. As the crew gathered in the hangar, the base, compacted into its transit form, loomed like a behemoth. The technology was cutting edge, incorporating adaptive materials and AI-assisted construction drones that would unfold and assemble the structure upon landing, a 50-yard by 50-yard walled-in safe zone. Rocker orders, "Drop the base, we will follow." Yet, as they prepared to escort this technological marvel to the surface, the crew was beset by apprehension. Each member knew the risks, remembered the creature's ferocity, and understood the daunting task of establishing a foothold in such a hostile world. Captain Rocker oversaw the operation with a keen eye. "We know what's waiting for us," he addressed his crew, his voice a firm anchor amidst the swirling doubts. "But we've got a job to do. For those we've lost, for those waiting for us to return, we'll get this base up and running." As the dropship carrying the base began its descent towards the planet, a tension filled the cabin. The crew, strapped in and grim-faced, watched the planet's surface approach, a world that had shown them both wonder and horror. The descent was a journey back into the lion's den, a deliberate march towards an uncertain fate, guided by duty and the faint hope of wealth. As the dropship touched down and the prefabricated base began its automated unfolding process, the sounds of the alien jungle filled the air, a reminder of the planet's hidden guardians. The crew stepped out, their resolve hardening at the sound of distant cries, the familiar roars of the creatures that awaited them in the shadows. "Marshals to the walls, men to work. The sooner we get it done, the sooner we can leave," Captain Rocker commanded. As the automated systems of the prefabricated base came to life, its panels and structures unfolding like a metallic flower blooming in fast forward, the alien jungle around them seemed to respond. The distant cries of the planet's fauna grew louder, a discordant symphony that hinted at an imminent storm of flesh and fury. The space marshals swiftly moved into position, their training and instincts taking over. They established defensive perimeters along the unfolding walls of the base, their weapons at the ready, eyes scanning the dense foliage for any sign of movement. The men worked feverishly to bring the base's systems online. Their fingers danced across control panels, activating defense mechanisms, environmental shields, and communication arrays. Each system coming to life was a small victory, a step closer to establishing a foothold on this hostile world. A man yells out, "Comms up but not running. We are deaf and blind, sir." The contrast between the two groups was stark. On one side, the marshals' training and instincts was their motivation, their faces set in grim lines, weapons poised for an onslaught. On the other, the technicians and scientists, their actions was fueled by a mixture of fear and adrenaline. But their concentration was unwavering as they navigated the complexities of the base's technology. As the base continued to take shape, its automated defenses coming online, the distant cries of the creatures grew closer, more fervent, as if the very land itself resented the foreign structure. The marshals tightened their grip on their weapons, exchanging brief, solemn nods of readiness. They were the thin line between survival and annihilation. In the dense foliage that fringed the newly forming base, the first sign of trouble stirred, a solitary creature, its exoskeletal frame a shadow against the vibrant alien underbrush, cautiously peered over the ridge facing the south wall. The air thick with anticipation as the marshals atop the wall held their breath, their eyes locked onto the creature. Captain Bick Rocker, standing resolute among his marshals, his gaze fixed on the horizon, felt a familiar surge of adrenaline. "See him, sir?" one of the marshals whispered. "Yeah, I see him." Rocker replied, his voice steady. With a deliberate motion, he reached for a pulse rifle, its sleek design belying the devastating power it housed. His hands, steady despite the situation, adjusted the weapon's settings, his fingers flicking the rifle to the overload setting, a risky maneuver designed for dire situations. The rifle hummed, a growing whine that filled the silence, warning lights blinking in protest against the imminent strain. The creature, sensing the impending danger, tilted its head, its primal instincts on edge. Then, with a precision that belied the tension of the moment, Rocker fired. The pulse rifle discharged with a thunderous roar, a streak of energy cutting through the air, finding its mark between the creature's eyes. The impact was immediate and catastrophic. The creature's head exploded in a shower of alien ichor, its body crumpling to the ground, the pulse rifle smoking and depleted of power. The marshal says, "Nice shot, sir." Yet, this act, a display of power and precision, was but a spark in a powder keg. What followed was a cacophony of roars as a herd of the creatures crested the hill. They charged, a tidal wave of flesh and fury, propelled by the scent of their fallen kin. The marshals, spurred into action by Rocker's leadership, opened fire, a barrage of energy pulses lighting up the twilight. Rocker, moving along the wall, issuing commands. "Focus fire! Hold the line!" he shouted, his voice cutting through the howls of the oncoming horde. The creatures, undeterred by the defensive hail, closed the distance with terrifying speed, their movements a blur of agility and primal rage. The marshal's discipline under Rocker's command held the creatures at bay, but only just. Each fallen creature was replaced by two more, their numbers seemingly endless, their ferocity undiminished. In the midst of the chaos, the base's automated defenses sprang to life, turrets joining the fray, their firepower adding to the wall of death that greeted the attackers. Yet, even with the technological might at their disposal, the marshals were hard-pressed, the creatures' resilience and sheer numbers a relentless tide, threatening to overwhelm them. Rocker, his orders, delivered with surgical precision, orchestrating the defense, maximizing the effectiveness of their limited numbers and firepower. His presence on the wall, rifle in hand, firing alongside his marshals, was a testament to his commitment to his crew, to their mission, and to the survival of all under his command. As the battle raged, the ground before the south wall became a no-man's land of fallen creatures and churned earth, the air filled with the stench of ozone and alien blood. The marshals, their energy weapons glowing hot with continuous fire, fought with a desperation born of the knowledge of that failure meant their deaths. Yet, in every shout of command from Rocker, in every coordinated volley of fire, there was a thread of hope, a belief that they could hold the line, that they could survive the onslaught and secure the base. His leadership keeping his men's hope alive. As the battle for the base raged on, the situation grew increasingly dire. The energy shields, a shimmering barrier between the crew and the relentless onslaught of the exoskeletal raptors, began to flicker and falter under the sustained assault. The sight of the weakening shield sent a wave of desperation through the ranks. They knew all too well that the shield's failure would leave them exposed to the primal fury of the creatures that seemed determined to reclaim their world from the human intruders. In the midst of the chaos, moments of personal bravery emerged like beacons in the dark. A young marshal, recognizing the imminent breach, charged forward to manually reboot a failing shield generator, his actions buying precious seconds for his comrades. Another, a technician, jury-rigged the base's communication array to emit a high-frequency pulse, disorienting the attackers and stemming their advance, if only momentarily. Despite their efforts, the tide of battle turned irrevocably when the shields gave out, disappearing with a final desperate flicker. The marshals, now standing on the brink, faced the creatures head-on, their weapons blazing trails of defiance into the encroaching horde. The base's automated turrets, their barrels glowing red from continuous fire, overheated and shut down one by one. Captain Rocker, amidst the bedlam, remained a pillar of strength. With a heavy heart, he gave the order that every commander dreads. fall back to the center, prepare for full evac. His voice, though strained, carried the weight of his resolve and the depth of his commitment to the safety of his crew. The defenders, rallying to his call, executed a fighting retreat, covering each other as they fell back to the dropship, their last hope for escape. The moments that followed were a blur of motion and emotion. Crew members, marshals, and scientists alike scrambled onto the dropship, their faces etched with the scars of battle and the specter of loss. Captain Rocker, ensuring every last person was aboard, made his way to the cockpit. With the creatures swarming over the hull, their weight and ferocity threatening to anchor the ship to the ground, the situation seemed hopeless. The dropship, designed for rapid deployment and retrieval, was ill-equipped to lift off under such conditions. Yet, in the face of certain doom, Rocker's command was unwavering. "Wiggle and thrust, boost us the hell out of here." The pilot, his hand steady at the controls, executed a series of evasive maneuvers, the ship lurching and twisting in a desperate attempt to dislodge the creatures clinging to its exterior. The engines, pushed to their limits, roared in protest as the ship struggled to gain altitude. Then, with a sudden surge of power, the boosters ignited fully, propelling the dropship away from the planet's surface, shedding the creatures into the void as it broke free from the planet's grasp. As the dust settled and the adrenaline began to wane, Captain Bick Rocker conducted a quick head count. To his astonishment, every soul that had embarked on this perilous endeavor was accounted for. "We left with everyone, and we've returned with everyone," Rocker murmured, a sense of relief washing over him. Turning to address his crew, his voice was steady and imbued with profound gratitude. "Your bravery out there today is what saved us. Thank you," he said, his words echoing in the cramped space of the dropship, binding the crew together in their shared ordeal. As he moved among his crew, offering words of thanks and acknowledgement, Rocker's gaze fell upon a marshal who had paid a grievous price in the battle. The man had lost a leg, now sutured off just below the knee. Rocker approached him, stopping a respectful distance away. With a solemnity reserved for the most sacred of moments, he saluted the marshal, an acknowledgement of his sacrifice and bravery. In response, the one-legged man, through a haze of pain and with a grimace that spoke volumes of his determination, he pushed himself. With the makeshift tourniquet staunching the flow of blood, the marshal stood on his remaining leg. "No, thank you, sir, for saving us," his voice cutting through the murmur of the ship. Raising his hand in a salute, he met Rocker's gaze, his expression a complex tapestry of pain, pride, and an unyielding spirit. The moment hung in the air, a poignant testament to the indomitable will of those who had faced death and emerged not unscathed, but undefeated. Witnessing this exchange, the men around them felt a surge of emotion, a collective recognition of the marshal's valor and the captain's leadership. Tears welled in the eyes of hardened soldiers, not as a sign of weakness, but as a tribute to the strength and sacrifice embodied by their comrade. Their return would not mark the end of their journey, but the beginning of a new chapter in the saga of humanity's quest to conquer the unknown. The battles they had fought, the fears they had overcome, and the lessons they had learned would resonate through the ages, a reminder of the cost of reaching into the darkness and the light that can be found there. And so, with the galaxy stretching out before them, the crew of the RJS Endeavor faced the future, forever changed, forever bound by the ties of shared adversity, and forever driven by the unquenchable human spirit to survive. Rock Jumpers, Episode 3. As the heavy thud of the dropship echoed through the RJS Endeavor's hangar bay, the crew inside allowed themselves a moment of serenity, basking in the safety of their metallic sanctuary amongst the stars. This fleeting sense of security was abruptly shattered, replaced by a crescendo of raw, guttural roars that pierced the temporary silence. The source of the disturbance was as shocking as it was unforeseen. Two alien creatures, their bodies battered and bleeding, had somehow hitched a ride on the landing gear, sneaking onto the ship as uninvited and deadly stowaways. The sudden intrusion turned the hangar bay from a place of welcome to a scene of chaos. the creatures, embodiments of the planet's hostile ecosystem, found themselves trapped in an unfamiliar environment, their primal instincts driving them to lash out. The crew, caught off guard and unprepared for such an encounter within the confines of the Endeavor, scrambled to respond. The initial shock of the creature's presence gave way to a surge of adrenaline, the fight-or-flight instinct taking hold. The tension in the hangar bay escalated as one of the marshals, reacting to the immediate threat, raised his weapon, intent on firing. Captain Bick Rocker intervened. His arm shot out, pushing the barrel of the rifle down. "You cannot fire that thing in here, son," he cautioned, his voice a mixture of command and calm. "You'll kill us all. Stick tight, move as one, back into the dropship, slowly." The crew's attempt to retreat was abruptly interrupted as the creatures charged. Unaccustomed to the ship's metal flooring, their feet slipped, sending them sliding across the hangar bay in a grotesque parody of their natural prowess. The ensuing collision was chaotic. The creature's unexpected tumble knocked several crew members off their feet, scattering them across the floor in all directions. Amid this turmoil, one creature's predicament stood out. A broken leg, likely sustained during its unintended journey, left it pinned against the landing gear, snapping and hissing in frustration and pain. The scene was one of utter disarray, with crew members trying to regain their footing and escape the unpredictable threat. A few of the scientists managed to retreat to the relative safety of the dropship, sealing the hatch behind them, leaving outside a marshal hindered by a missing leg that found himself face to face with one of the creatures, its growl a prelude to the violence that followed. The beast's growl was the last sound the marshal heard before it was upon him, tearing him apart with ruthless efficiency. Thinking quickly, Rocker hurled his pulse rifle at the creature, drawing its attention. "Over here!" he yelled, baiting it. As the creature charged, Rocker executed a daring somersault, sliding past it. The creature, unable to adjust its speed or traction on the metal floor, crashed into the hangar wall, momentarily dazed. In this moment of crisis, Captain Rocker's leadership shined brightly. His quick thinking diverted the creature's attention, offering a sliver of hope amidst the desperation. His order to evacuate the hangar was clear, his actions providing a distraction for the crew's frantic escape. But this left Rocker in a deadly dance with an alien predator, a scenario far removed from the strategic battles he was accustomed to commanding. His crew, now safe behind sealed doors, could only watch as their captain became the hunted, a lone figure against a menacing beast. Rocker, his heart pounding in his chest, made a split-second decision to dash for the main hangar door, the creature's guttural snarls filling the air behind him. The beast, driven by a primal hunger, chased after him, its claws scraping the metal floor with each stride, nipping at Rocker's heels. As he weaves and dodges, left and right, the beast mirroring his every move but struggles for traction on the slick surface. Sure footing and agility were Bick's only advantages. In a daring maneuver, Rocker reversed direction, sliding beneath the leaping creature. He felt the whoosh of its body overhead, narrowly avoiding a bite that could have spelled his end. As he rolled between its legs, the creature, unprepared for his quick thinking, tumbled end over end in a confused mass of limbs, slamming into the hangar door, blocking Rocker's escape. A marshal re-entered the hangar, knife in hand, the hatch closing with a metallic thud behind him. Seizing the moment, he launched himself at the creature from behind, taking advantage of its diverted attention. The scene that unfolded was primal and fierce. The marshal, embodying the raw courage of a rodeo star, mounted the beast, stabbing it repeatedly in the neck. Each thrust was a desperate bid for survival, but the creature, in a display of brutal strength, flung him with a violent toss into the hangar door. The sound of breaking bones echoed through the air, a chilling prelude to the horror that followed. With a swift, merciless bite, the creature ripped the marshal's arm off, the violence of the act painting a stark portrait of the alien predator's lethal capabilities. The marshal's final screams pierced the hangar as he made one last valiant stab before being devoured. In the aftermath of witnessing such a gut-wrenching sacrifice, Captain Bick Rocker's instincts kicked into high gear. The horror and valor displayed before him catalyzed a rush of adrenaline that set his feet in motion, compelling him to sprint towards the relative sanctuary of the dropship. But his escape was abruptly halted by a grotesque sight that ensnared his attention and chilled his blood. There, in a display of raw, animalistic desperation, the second raptor, its leg cruelly pinned beneath the heavy landing gear of the dropship, committed an act of self-mutilation that was stark and horrifying. With savage determination and a chilling disregard for its own agony, the creature bit down on its trapped limb, severing it in a gruesome spectacle of blood and sinew. The sound of flesh tearing, bones crunching, and the creature's own pained roars filled the hangar, Bick witnessing a tableau of survival instincts in its most primal state. The sight of the raptor, now freed but severely wounded, hobbling on its maimed stump, was both pitiful and terrifying. Its eyes, fueled by pain and rage, fixed on Rocker, igniting a new level of fear and urgency within him. As he looked over his shoulder, Rocker realized he was caught now in a deadly game of pickle, a perverse game of survival against not one, but two raptors. Without a moment's hesitation, Rocker pressed forward, choosing to confront the hobbling creature directly in his path. As he neared, the injured raptor lunged in a last-ditch attempt to catch its prey, its movements clumsy and pained. Rocker, relying on his well-honed reflexes, easily sidestepped the desperate swipe, watching as the creature's momentum carried it forward, only to collapse in a heap. This maneuver, however, had an unintended consequence. The first raptor, still in pursuit, was unable to halt its charge, tripping over its injured counterpart. The two beasts tumbled in a chaotic mass of limbs and snarls, giving Rocker the distraction he needed. With the path now clear and his heart pounding in his ears, he seized the opportunity, sprinting with renewed vigor towards the hangar door. This chase, a harrowing blend of terror, instinct, and sheer will to survive, tested Rocker's limits as he navigated the dangers that lurked within the supposed safety of the endeavor. As he neared the hangar door, the sounds of the creature's frustrated roars and the cacophony of their tangled struggle echoed behind him. Just as he reached the hangar door, which remained stubbornly closed, stuck from the dent the creature had put in it, Rocker faced the raptors. They stood up at the base of the dropship. They charge, his back to the door, the intensity in the beast's eyes a clear promise of a gruesome end. Just then, a sudden roar filled the hangar. A sound so loud it momentarily disoriented both predator and prey. It was the dropship, its engines flaring to life in a blinding burst of light and heat. The scientist on board, in a move of sheer genius, had ignited the engines for a brief but powerful moment, directing the scorching blast towards the creatures. As the dropship's engines roared to life, the two menacing raptors found themselves directly in the path of destruction. The engines, designed to propel the craft through the vacuum of space, became instruments of instantaneous annihilation. A torrent of searing heat and blinding light erupted from the exhausts, transforming the area around the dropship into a furnace of unparalleled ferocity. The raptors, caught in the maelstrom of energy, were subjected to forces beyond their evolutionary comprehension. The intense heat, reaching temperatures that could melt metal, enveloped the creatures in a cocoon of fire. For a fleeting moment, their forms became silhouettes against a backdrop of incandescent fury. The process of disintegration was merciless and swift. The outer layers of their exoskeletons, though tough and designed for the rigors of their native environment, offered no resistance against the thermal onslaught. The high-energy heat rapidly penetrated their bodies, vaporizing organic tissues with ruthless efficiency. Muscles, internal organs, and bodily fluids evaporated in an instant, leaving behind only a faint trace of their biological essence in the air. As the blast continued, even the durable exoskeletons began to succumb. They cracked and splintered under the extreme temperature, breaking down into their constituent molecules, which were then carried away by the force of the exhaust. What remained in the wake of the engine's fury was nothing but a fine dust scattered across the hangar floor, the only physical testament to the creature's existence. The entire episode lasted but a few minutes, yet in that brief span, the raptors were reduced from fearsome predators to mere memories, erased from existence by the technological might at humanity's command, leaving a lingering silence in the hangar that spoke volumes of the ordeal that had just transpired. Captain Bickrocker knew that this encounter was a turning point. It underscored the precarious nature of their mission and the unpredictable challenges of exploring the unknown. The crew of the RJS Endeavor had survived another day, but the saga of their journey through the cosmos was far from over. ROCKJUMPERS, Episode 4. In the wake of the harrowing raptor attack within the cold, metallic confines of the RJS Endeavor's hangar, the air was thick with a mixture of relief, grief, and simmering tension. Captain Bickrocker found himself supported by the marshals, who had hastily pried the hangar door open to come to his aid. The sense of camaraderie among them did little to mask the undercurrent of unease that followed the recent violence. "Are you okay, Captain?" one marshal asked, his voice betraying the collective concern for their leader, who had once again faced death head-on for the sake of his crew. The arrival of the two scientists from the dropship, their faces a canvas of worry, momentarily shifted the focus from introspection to accusation. Their immediate questions about the crew's well-being were abruptly silenced by a marshal's sudden, violent outburst. The punch, thrown with a raw, unfiltered mix of anger and betrayal, landed with a thud against one scientist's jaw. The physical act, a manifestation of the marshal's anguish over the loss of Johnny. "You locked Johnny out," he accused, his voice a serrated edge cutting through the murmur of the ship. The ensuing scuffle, with the scientist shoved against the wall, the claim from the scientists that they had no choice, did little to quell the rising storm. As the marshal's rifle leveled at them, a threat of retribution hanging in the air, the tension reached a boiling point. It was Captain Rocker's intervention, his hand calmly pressing down the barrel of the rifle, that averted further violence. "They truly had no choice," he stated, his voice a steadying force amidst the turmoil. His acknowledgement of the grim reality that Johnny's fate had been sealed by his injuries, making his survival impossible, was a bitter pill for the crew to swallow. Yet, Rocker's subsequent actions revealed the complex layers of leadership and moral responsibility. The second scientist, who had brazenly claimed to have saved the captain's life with the dropship, the captain's sudden punch to the second scientist, "I said I understood your choice. I did not say I agreed with it," Bick announced. This underscored a harsh truth. Survival in the unforgiving expanse of space was a shared burden, marred by difficult choices that could not be undone or taken lightly. The command to place the scientists in cryosleep, to let the law adjudicate their actions back on Earth, was Rocker's way of navigating the murky waters of accountability and justice. "Put them on ice until we get home," Bick ordered. This chapter of the Endeavor's saga, steeped in the immediate aftermath of violence and the struggle to reconcile with the choices made, painted a stark picture of life on the edge of human exploration. The ethical quandaries faced by the crew, the weight of decisions made in moments of crisis, and the leadership required to steer through them were encapsulated in the somber mood that enveloped the ship. The scientists, placed in cryosleep as a temporary resolution, became symbols of the broader debate about duty, sacrifice, and survival that would undoubtedly continue to haunt the crew. In the dim light of the RJS Endeavor's bridge, Captain Bickrocker stood alone, a solitary figure against the backdrop of the vast, indifferent expanse of space that stretched beyond the viewport. The aftermath of the raptor attack lingered in his mind. Now, as he initiated the quantum communication array, he braced himself for a different kind of confrontation, one that pitted the immediate, raw experiences of his crew against the distant, calculated decisions of ROCKJUMPERS Corporation's brass. The connection buzzed to life, and the holographic displays flickered, projecting the stern faces of the corporate executives. Their expressions, a mix of disapproval and concern, set the tone for the conversation. "Captain Rocker," began the lead executive, her voice cold and clear, "we've received your preliminary report. To say we are disappointed is an understatement. The loss of the base and the failure to secure the planet's resource rights are significant setbacks. Rocker, his posture unyielding, responded with a measured calm. With all due respect, we faced unforeseen circumstances. The local fauna presented a level of aggression and resilience we were not equipped to handle. Our priority was the safety of the crew. The executives exchanged glances, their skepticism visible, even through the digital divide. Safety is paramount, yes, but so is the mission. The resources on that planet represent a considerable opportunity for Rockjumpers. Your inability to secure the base has put us at a competitive disadvantage. The tension in the conversation escalated as new orders were delivered. Effective immediately, your crew is to enter cryo sleep. The DS Victory will be rerouted to your location. They have the firepower and manpower to establish a base. Your crew will debrief them upon their arrival and assist in any way necessary. Rocker's jaw tightened at the orders, the demand for cryo sleep and the waiting game. Rocker replied, "There is only a handful of us left, 22 to be exact, 4 being marshals." Rocker replied, "Do not see how we can really help. Request beacon deployment and evac." The executive's response was dismissive, a clear indication of their priorities. "The DS Victory is fully equipped to handle any contingencies. Your role now is to ensure that the transition is seamless. The corporation expects you to follow these orders without deviation." As the communication ended, Rocker was left staring at the now dark displays, the silence of the bridge amplifying the isolation and frustration he felt, the corporation's disappointment and the impersonal nature of their orders, the expectation to simply step aside, to freeze their lives in cryo sleep and wait for another crew to help them take over, felt like a betrayal, a dismissal of their sacrifice and bravery. The captain went to face his crew, who had gathered quietly in the mess hall during the call. Rocker's decision to relay the corporate orders to put his crew in cryo sleep and await the arrival of the DS Victory was delivered with a heavy heart. "We sleep till Victory arrives," he announced, his voice steady but the undertone of dissent clear. "We do what we're ordered to do." The crew's reaction was mixed, a blend of resignation and quiet defiance. The realization that their journey was far from over, that they would be awakened to aid a mission they had started but were no longer leading, sat uneasily with them all. Amidst the growing unease and discontent over the corporate orders to enter cryosleep and await the DS Victory's arrival, the crew of the RJS Endeavor voiced their grievances and concerns to Captain Bick Rocker. The heart of their unrest was the uncertainty over the promised bonuses and what tangible rewards their perilous efforts would yield. Sensing the need for reassurance, Rocker convened a meeting, addressing his crew, the only bright spot in this entire ordeal. He began, his voice steady and confident, "is that the corporation has confirmed our mining claim rights. Though it's a small percentage of the profits, the value of a find like this cannot be overstated. We're talking about a paycheck every year for the life of the mine's production. For a discovery of this magnitude, that means wealth beyond our wildest dreams." His words hung in the air. The promise of ongoing compensation, tied directly to the success of the mining operation on the alien world, was indeed a hard proposition to dismiss. With measured nods and a collective understanding of the stakes involved, the crew agreed. There was a sense of unfinished business, of a chapter in their saga that was yet to be written. The journey of the RJS Endeavor and the men and women who called her home was a testament to the human capacity for endurance, for facing the darkness of the unknown. As they slipped into cryo sleep, their story paused but not ended, waiting for the moment they would awaken to face the challenges of a new day. This is not goodbye, nor the end. Until the story continues, my friends. B. and Rocker.